Okay.
I'm recording this screen and I will put it there. Don't worry. Now, we are going to discuss something about this basics of CUDA programming. In between, if you will have some questions, you can raise your voice. You can ask me the question. Now, as we are going to deal with this CUDA programming, let me remind you that we are dealing with data parallelism. Okay. What happened till now, if I try to remind you from the last classes, that we have seen that there is something called GPU. This GPU is basically designed for data parallelism. Okay, do you remember there is something called this thing, multi-threads and multi-data kind of things? So for a single program, multi-data, right? Even I am forgetting, come on. Single program, multiple data, or you have to understand that what happens in data parallelism. Basically, if we have different data and we want to use the same instruction to perform on different data, in that case, we can use this GPU architecture or similar architectures. So definitely we have already understood actually that there was a difference between single instruction multiple data and this single program multi-data, where in single instruction there was only one instruction which was being executed at one time instance in all the threads, in all the different arithmetic units, I suppose. But in this kind of program, there can be different instruction, however the single set of instructions are being executed. At one time instance, different instructions might be executing on one arithmetic unit. So, for example, we are taking this simple example of vector addition. The two vectors, as we have discussed earlier also, the two vectors, vector A and vector B, we want to perform addition on these two vectors. And we want to store the result in the third vector C. So here for index 0, we want to perform addition A0, B0 and store the result in C0. Then similarly for all the indexes. So here we can see that we can have different arithmetic units to perform this kind of operation. Now, let me ask you, till now, is it clear or not? Is it clear till now? Just one. Is it clear? Acha, huh. Repeat, sir. Yes, sir. Okay. Hey, the basic thing that we wanted to learn today is our data parallelism. In this data parallelism, basically, we have a GPU. In GPU, as we remember, there are thousands of arithmetic units, right? And we can treat these arithmetic units for executing as a different threads. So different threads means we have okay. Do you understand what a thread is? In a simplified view, it is just how a processor executes a sequential program, right? But a thread consists of the code of the program, the particular point of the code that is being executed, and the values of its variables and data structures. Anna? The execution of the thread is sequential as far as the as a user is concerned. So you can use whatever different kind of monitors are there, but the important thing is we want to perform some operation on different data. So what we can do is we can use different arithmetic units. Let me call it processors. So if I'm saying different processors, I'm saying GPU is having different multiple processing units, I should say. So if we want to perform some operation on different data, we assign these data to different processing units and ask them to perform the operation. So the number of different data that we have, according to this number of different data, we will make different threads. If we have n number of data to operate on, we will create n different threads. Okay, let me say we will execute on different, I should say, n processing units. And this execution on different n processing units, we will call it execution of n different threads. So here in data parallelism, the only thing that you have to understand is in this slide actually, that if we want to perform addition of two vectors, A and B, the first option we had was normal, I should say traditional C programming, in which we will have a loop which will perform the addition, but it will not be parallel execution. However, now we can have parallel execution with GPU, because in GPU we have multiple processing units. So if we want to perform addition of n indexes, in that case, you can see if we want to perform addition of A0 and B0 and store the result in C0, it has nothing to do with A1, B1. Means it is not being disturbed by others, or neither it is disturbing any other data value. In that case, we can definitely assign this operation task to different processing units, as well as we can show them, I should say, dedicate them that this is the part of data on which you have to execute, perform the operation, and store the result in this location. You have not to worry about the other locations in the memory. In that case, now, if it could have been a little larger. So now you have to start with the CUDA kind of thing. Here what we are dealing is how actually CUDA program, I should say, what is the structure of CUDA program. For now, you were having a traditional C programming language. For this traditional C programming language, you were using your, compiler. Now, in this programming, in this CUDA programming, basically, you will have to write some other codes other than the traditional C programming. So, let me repeat. Now you are going to learn CUDA C programming. In this CUDA C programming, all the codes that were being executed in traditional C are acceptable. In addition to those traditional C programming constructs, you will have new methods, new functions as well. So, that traditional C compiler is no longer useful. Now, here, if you can see, this is something like how you can execute your CUDA C program. I am telling you that in your CUDA C program, you will have your normal C code, traditional C code, as well as some new code also. So now, you will need a new compiler. We call it NVCC, NVIDIA CUDA compiler. This NVIDIA CUDA compiler will help you in compiling your CUDA programs. CUDA programs will be having .cu extension. Here, this is your basically what it is saying is you have some host code and some device code. Host code means your the part of the code you want to execute on CPU, and device code means the part of the code that you want to execute on your device. Device means a GPU, typically in our CUDA setting. Okay, so let me repeat. Host code is your code that is going to be executed on CPU, and device code is the code which is going to execute on your GPU. So the host code is normal, I should say traditional C code only. However, device code, the part of the device code is new. It is in addition to the traditional C codes. This compiler NVCC will help you in compiling your CUDA code, which is having both kind of codes, host code as well as device code. Okay, so we can call it as a heterogeneous computing platform here, where you can compile your code, which is having some code which is to be executed on CPU and some code which is to be executed on GPU. Basically, the serial codes which are not much parallelizable or very few threads you are creating, those kind of codes you can execute on CPU. And if you have large number of threads you want to execute, you can write the code for GPU. We will see how to write this code. Basically, here in this slide, you have to understand is that in a code we can have some serial code which has to execute on CPU, and then some codes which has to execute on GPU. And this might be repeated in your program, no issues. So now you can understand that you have a CUDA program. In this CUDA program, you have a part of code which is to execute on CPU, a part of code which is to execute on GPU. Then what do you need next? You want to compile it. For compiling, you will use NVCC compiler. Very good. All done. Sir, what is a serial code? Serial code means normal code normal code that we write in the C setting. Serial, actually, you can understand serial by understanding as sequential, means one after another, a code which is being executed one after another. Okay, and a part of code which we need to be parallelized, that is parallel code. Okay, that is the thing. Anything more till now? Okay. Now, let us assume we want to add a vector and we are not using the GPU. In that case, you will write a function. I'm calling it vec add function. This vec add function will have a for loop, whatever, a loop, which will add the ith index value of A and B and store the result in C. No issues. Right? So for this, what you are doing, you are having a function here. You are declaring it void vec add. No problem. You are calling this function from here. You are allocating the memory to these three variables, A, B, and C. And you are calling this function. You are giving these variables as argument. And here you are in this function, you are adding these two values and storing the result in C. This is a normal program, no issues. But if you want to execute this thing on GPU, you will have to make a little change. Okay, what kind of change it could be? You have to understand you have a CPU and a GPU. Okay. And you have a memory in CPU and a memory in GPU. Now you have to ask something. No. If you have to ask something, you can write in the checkbox. So now, I was telling you that just we have seen a program where we had a function and we allocated the memory on our the CPU side, host side, and the function is also executing on our CPU. We send this variables here and we executed the perform the addition of the vector in a for loop. Now what we are thinking is, how can we do this thing? How can we execute our operation addition of two vector in using GPU? If we want to use GPU, we have to understand CPU called as host. Sir, I'm not getting why CPU called as host while GPU called as device. This is just convention. This is this has nothing to do with programming. This is just a convention that we call CPU side as host side and GPU side as device side. It is also because the program that we actually have and we are executing, the interface is on the CPU side only. So from CPU side, all the other executions, whatever we do, and the application that we will be running, maybe command prompt or any other application, will run on CPU side only. And GPUs, for now, what the situation is, GPUs are not that rich to handle those all the issues that CPUs can handle. So basically, if we have compute intensive works, we are using GPU. So we will keep the GPU in our system, no issues. Whenever we need some GPU, sorry, compute intensive work, we will call this our function on the GPU side, and we will take the result back, and the job is done. So while on CPU, we are on CPU host side, and we call this GPU as a device. So when we want to execute with this GPU, what we need to do? Okay, we want to perform the addition of two vectors, right? So we will have to allocate memory. Okay, maybe if we want to have this allocation on device side, then on device side also. Let me tell you, on device side also, you have a RAM. You have a different kind of a storage. We will see what are those storage, but for now we will consider the RAM, the global memory. So we will have to allocate memory on the GPU side. Then we will launch the kernel. Launching the kernel means a function that will allocate those compute devices. I should say, the processing units of the GPU to execute this particular code. There will be a function, a particular code which is to be executed, and we will allocate those compute resources, and we will execute. Sir, iska code bhi saath mein steps wise dikhate to sahi rehta. Okay, ye bhi hum log dekhenge. For now, let me tell you the basic steps, and then we will see the code as well. The basic step is just these three, that what we want is we will allocate the memory on the device side, launch the kernel. What the kernel is? The function which will use the data from the memory and the code from the memory, whatever code and the data, execute it, perform the operation, and store the result back in the memory. Which memory? Device memory. Okay. And then in the third step, we need to copy the memory back from the device, from the GPU to our host side, CPU side. And after that, we will free the device memory that we have allocated. Okay. So now next, I have to show you something about the memory. So what happens in this memory is that we have RAM on both sides, host side as well as device side. And we have some way, some methods, some, I should say, CUDA methods, which is just extension of our normal traditional C programming, which can be used to copy the data from one memory to another memory, from the host to device or to device to host. Let me repeat. We can copy the data from one memory to another, and another, host to device, device to host. These all the things are possible. For now, you should also understand that if we are on host and we want to allocate memory on device side, there should be a method. Let me remind you that you are on host means CPU side, and you want to allocate memory on host side only. You have a function, you call it malloc. Okay. Malloc is a function. You want to allocate some memory on this host side. It is possible in traditional C programming. For now, let me tell you, there is a possibility you want to allocate memory on device side. Hana? For that, you have some function. We call it CUDA malloc. Let me remind you, malloc was a function in traditional C programming. CUDA malloc is new in CUDA, just an extension of this C programming, where CUDA malloc is used to allocate the memory on device side. Okay, it will take two parameters. What are these two parameters? Address of the pointer to the allocated object. Okay, let me make it clear that this pointer is to be created on the host side. Okay, then address of this pointer you will specify. We will see the code, don't worry. It is here in this code here, I think. Okay, here in the next slide only. And then you will specify the size in bytes that you want to have allocated on the GPU. Sir, it will return the address of memory allocated. Yeah. It will return the address of memory allocated on the device side. Okay. And so here actually, okay, next slide, let me show you that what you're writing. Okay, what happened? So you will create pointer. You will specify some size, and then you are writing CUDA malloc. This is the address of your pointer, and this is a typecasting. Basically, what happens here in this first parameter? The first parameter is the address of the pointer variable, right? Which will be set to point to the allocated object in the device memory, you know? Now this address should be cast to void star. Why? Because the function expects a generic pointer. What does it mean, right? The memory allocation function is a generic function that is not restricted to any particular type of objects. Yeah. Actually, this CUDA malloc actually returns a generic object. It makes the use of whatever the device, let me repeat it, CUDA malloc returns a generic object, the memory allocated on the device side. How much memory is specified by the size? If you remember in the normal malloc function, you have just to specify the size. Why? Because you need not, because in that case the memory was being allocated on the left, on the host side only. Sir, we are casting it to void pointer, but DA data type is float. Yes, this data type is float. We are we are not typecasting in a particular one thing. We are typecasting in a generic. Double star means we are typecasting it into a generic pointer, so it can point to anything, right? That is what it means. So using this function, we can allocate memory on device side, and we can access it using DA. Means D just we have kept to keep track of this variable is on device side, nothing else. So you are asking, and DA is address. Yeah, definitely. It is address of something, which whose address? It is address of DA. We are working on address, not on variable. Yeah, it's okay. No issues. Basically, we want to have the address of the object or the memory allocated on the device side in DA. All right. So CUDA malloc will help us in understanding, sorry, in allocating memory on device side and accessing it using DA. For that, if you have to write it like address of DA, no issues. So once it is has been done, you can use the this DA and perform some operation, and then in the last you should free this memory. So now once we have allocated memory, one more thing that we have to see is transferring data from one side to another. Basically, for this purpose, you will be using CUDA memcpy. What does this CUDA memcpy does? It is able to transfer the data from one kind of memory to another, host to device or device to host kind of. Okay. So now it actually takes four parameters. Pointer to destination, source, bytes, size, and then the direction of the transfer. Please send the slide also. Okay, I will send you the slide also. Okay, you want me to send the slide right now, you are saying? What is meaning of direction here? Okay. Here the direction means from host to device or device to host. Okay. So let me share this thing with you. How can I do that? I have shared this thing, Anna. So go through, you can also access there. Now Gaurav is asking, sir, we have the destination and source address. Is it not sufficient to tell the direction? It should be, very good. It should be sufficient, but if they are saying we have to do, they might have found something, but for now, as we have seen, we have to go through this thing and we will have to use this kind of option only. So the option is the four option, destination and source, and number of bytes copied, and direction. For example, you can write something like this. You have these two pointers, right? And you want to copy from host to device. The direction is usually, you will write the direction in this way only. CUDA memcpy host to device, or CUDA memcpy device to host. These are some constants already defined and which are used while CUDA memcpy. So if you want to copy something from device to host, you will write it like this, and host to device, you will write like this. It is also possible sometimes to copy from device to device, but actually you cannot copy from one GPU to another GPU. If at all you had having multiple GPUs in the system, you cannot copy data from one GPU to another. However, you can copy data from a GPU to the host and host to GPU. So if you want to use here in a program, what you can do is you can have these two pointers. I should say DA, another is A. Let me tell you, A is here our host memory. A is in our host memory. DA is in our device memory. We have just now allocated memory here, you can see. And then we are copying data from A to device A. Okay. B to device B. And then we will, this thing, we are allocating some memory in device DC. Then we are calling a kernel function. We will see how to call a kernel function. But here we are calling the kernel function. This, let us assume that this kernel function will perform the operation and store the result in DC. And then we will copy back the value of DC in our host side variable C. And we will use CUDA mem CPY device to host. Okay. Then later on we can free the memory. Then you can also handle some error here. What you have to do while calling this kind of function, CUDA malloc or CUDA mem CPY, this kind of function, due to some reason, it may have some kind of error. And the error may be the device memory was full, or some other errors are possible. So you can, this always returns the error. If you don't write it, no issues, it will work. But if you will write it, it will take the error in this variable. And later on, you can use to print whatever the error was there. If at all you want to handle the error, you can use you can have a condition. Using this condition, you can check whether there was some error or not. If there was some error, you can work accordingly. You want to print something, you can exit, you or you want to continue or whatever you want to do. So this was something about error handling. So till now you have learned some of the things. Till now, whatever you have learned, do you have to ask something? Do you have to ask something? For now, let me remind, we have learned something about CUDA programming. Like in this CUDA programming, we will have CUDA malloc to specify, I should say, allocate memory on the device side, and then CUDA mcpy to copy data from one location to another, host to device or device to host kind of thing. Now, for now, we don't know how to launch a kernel, right? Let us go toward launching a kernel. Actually, what we want is, we want a part of code. A part of code which should be executed by multiple threads. Okay. So Let me show you this thing first. This is a kernel function. In this kernel function, this is a declaration __global__. Okay. Then the function name, arguments, and whatever you want to do here. This function declaration global specifies that this is a function which can be called from a host function. Okay. This is a global which can be called from host function. However, in place of this global, you can also write __device__ or host. If you will write device, in that case, it can be called from device functions only. Okay, from the device side only. Maybe from this kernel, which is being executed on device side. Hana? There, from there also you can call such function, but you cannot call it from host. You, by default, if you will not write anything global, device, or host, by default it is host function. Any function, if at all specified as host, it will be available on host side, and it can be called from host functions only. Now, in a function, you can also write host as well as device. Host as well as device. In that case, we will have object have two separate functions, one for host and another for this thing, device. So now let us see that this is a function where we want to add two vectors A and B and store the result in C. This function, we have a variable int I. Oh, it is one. Okay, no, it is I. Huh? Int I. Now, on the device side, you are having multiple compute units, multiple processing units. I should say multiple threads. Sir, function ka first line samajh nahi aaya. Thread id x dot x. Haan, theek hai. Wo main bolta. So in this first line, you are writing int I is equal to something. So what we are understanding is this function will be executed by multiple threads. Thread will be launched, definitely a thread will be launched. While launching the thread, you will specify how many threads you want, right? Actually, I should show how to launch a kernel first. For launching the kernel, you will write vec at, I mean, whatever the function name is, and you will give the arguments here. Here in between, three times less than and three times greater than. In between, you are specifying something, comma something. Okay, this is actually the grid of threads that you are building, right? It says the number of blocks you want, and it says the number of threads you want in each block. Okay, so it is saying that you want 256 threads in each block. Actually, it is n by 256, zero is not there. So, and you are having n by 256 blocks. Okay, maybe for example, if you are having 512, if you want to create 512 threads, in that case, you will have 2,256. In that case, here you will have two blocks and each block having 256 threads. Okay. So if you will call a function with a setting like you want to create 1000 threads, in that case what will happen? You will have 256 here and here. 1000 divided by 256, around 3 point something, ceiling of it is 4. So 4,256, which means you will have 4 blocks with 256 threads in each block. Then what will happen? You will have, say, 4 blocks, 4 separate blocks, and each block you will have 256 threads. And each thread will be executing same part of code. What is the code? These two lines, right? I is equal to something, and if I is less than n, you will perform the addition. Now, what actually you can understand here is, you have a separate copy of variable I. They are called automatic variables here. So a variable I, a copy of variable I for each thread. Okay, for each thread you will have this I. Okay, so something if you do with this a variable in one thread will not affect the variable in another thread. If you have 1000 threads, I should say 1024 threads, in that case you will have 1024 variable, different variable I each thread. Okay. Now, here you have a thread ID x dot x, block dim dot x, and into block ID x dot x. ID x means index, dim means dimension. From where I should start? Block IDX dot x. Block IDX dot x means, by dot x you should understand there might be dot y and dot z also, right? For now, you should understand that there is something called block index. Block index, you should understand for now that we have just seen that there can be 4 blocks. So block 0, block 1, block 2, block 3. So block index. There is something called block index. This is something called block dim. This is the dimension of block. Dimension of block is actually the number of threads in each block. Okay? The number of threads in each block. Now there is something called thread IDX dot x. Thread IDX. Now in one block, there are, if in our example, there are 256 threads. So in one block, we are having 256 threads. So block index was the index of block, and the thread index is the index of each thread in a block. So if a thread is executing this function, this part of code, each thread will have separate value for these variables. You can understand it will have a different value for at least thread idx dot x. Maybe in the same block, the block index may be same, but thread index will definitely differ for all the all these things, all these threads. So basically what will happen, for each thread, you are accessing the position I. I means what is n code. What is N in code? What is N in code? Okay. N is actually the number of threads we want. You are saying that while calling this function, you are definitely sending A, B, and C, as well as you are sending N. Why are you sending this N? N specifies the number of threads we want. As I told you, that while creating this function, 256, and this specifies N by 256. You can write it manually also, no issues, but it is multiple of 256 as long it is. I will come Monu to you. You are asking size allocated H code may write some more about this. N is the size allocated. No, N is not size allocated. N is actually the number of threads that we want. N is the number of threads we want. So we wanted 1,000 threads. Okay, we wanted 1,000 threads. So N is 1,000. If at all N is 1,000, we divided it by 256. We got the ceiling and we got 4. 4 comma 256. So 4 blocks, each block having 256 threads. In that case, you are having 256 cross 4, which is 1024, 1024 threads. Okay, you are calling this function to be executed on 1024 threads. So you need N to specify on which threads this should be executed, and we will leave the last, rest 24 threads. We want to execute only on 1000 threads. So we will check whether this I thread ID, we are finding out the thread ID. How are we finding a thread ID? Since every thread has a thread index as well as block dim and block IDX value, we are using this information to find out this index of this thread. And if this thread index is less than 1000, we are executing. If it is not less than 1000, we are not executing, we are not performing this function. Okay, so this is what we had to learn, if I am not missing something. We had to learn here what is X in this. Okay, X is the dimension. What I am saying is, let me show you the code. Here you are specifying something, comma, something. Okay, something, comma, something means number of blocks and number of threads. Let me tell you one thing. Although in next chapter we have to see the detail on this, but for now I should tell you that this is the block dimension, and after comma this is the let me repeat. Before comma it says how many blocks you want, and after comma it says how many threads you want in each block. Okay, so the number of threads can also be three dimensional. Okay, and number of blocks can also be three dimensional. Okay, so basically I should say it should be a grid, comma, grid. There can be a three dimensional grid of block, and in each block we can have a grid of thread. Okay, we will see in next chapter how to specify the grid of threads for each block, and a grid of this thing, blocks also, and how to access these things, and that will help us in understanding matrix manipulation more easily. For now, you should understand that thread IDS dot x means x dimension only. This is just a linear value. Okay, just we are here in our example, we have called just x comma x. Huh? So this is a grid of blocks. If we are writing here 4, it means 1 comma 1 comma 4. Here we are writing 256, it means 1 comma 1 comma 256. Okay, then we are using just x dimension. However, there is a possibility to use y and z dimension as well. Thread idx dot x, and then there will be thread idx dot y or z also if we are having a grid of threads. For now, we are just having a vector of threads, okay, in x dimension only. Now, so for now, what we have done is we have created a function where we have allocated memory on the device side, copied the memory on the device side for both A and B. We have allocated memory on device side DC, and we have called this function with a specified number of threads as we want. And we performed the execution. The kernel function was written like this with underscore underscore global. We have performed the summation of A and B using this index. Using this index, we are able to access different data in different thread, perform the addition and store in CI. And then what will happen? This is just on the device side only, right? It has been performed, addition is performed, but it is performed on the device side only. So it's still the result in our device side. So next, what we have to do is, after this kernel is executed, we have to copy the memory, the data from device side C to host side C. There you go. And then we will free the device side memories. And if you want to print the result, you can use the host side C variable. Then the next thing is summary. I will come to it. Let me say the summary, and then in summary, actually what we have seen till now is the function declaration, kernel launch, predefined variables, and runtime APIs. So for declaration, we can use underscore underscore device underscore underscore host or global also. If you use the global, you can call this function from your host function. If you will have this define a kernel as device, you can call from device function only. For launching, you will write three times less than, three times greater than, in between the function name and argument, and specify a grid of block and a grid of threads in each block. If you will not specify, if you will specify only one value comma one value, in that case, it will have the x dimension only, okay? Predefined variables, there are certain predefined variables. You can see thread idx, block dim and block idx, which will be used to store the values of your values after the kernel is launched. When the kernel is launched, it has some values for block dimension and thread dimension. Now these are some APIs, CUDA MLOC, CUDA Free, and CUDA WebCPY. So you can use these functions. So now you can ask some questions if what you have, whatever you want to ask from this section. So in this session, you have to understand that a basic program, basic CUDA program, will have some extension from the traditional C, where traditional C programs will also execute here. You can have a kernel function, which is to execute on device side. You can use some APIs defined here in CUDA.C to allocate the memory, to free the memory, and also copy the data from one memory to another. So now you can ask some question. Do you want to ask some questions? You can unmute your mic and ask question. No doubt until now. Others. Anurag. In a program, let me tell you. See, in this program, this is a function which is being executed on host side. Okay, all the line of code here are being executed on host side. These are all serial code. Here is one line which is calling a function. Okay. This line is just calling a function. This is also being executed on host side and calling a function vec add by specifying the number of threads on which this function should execute. Okay. Now, when this function is being executed, maybe this function would have been written somewhere with global declaration. Now this function will execute on device side. So when this function will execute on device side, it will definitely execute with different threads, multiple processors. But for now, if we have written something like this, all this is being executed on host side. If at all we want to execute something on device side, we will have a separate function with its proper declaration with global to execute, to call from host side, and device to call from some device functions or kernel function. ठीक है. मैं यहाँ पे पूछना चाहूंगा कि अभी जो हम लोगों ने कोड लिखा है, इसमें तुम्हें क्या लगता है, हमने बताया है या कुड़ा खुद से समझा है? वेरी गुड, वेरी गुड. यही हमें करना पड़ता है, हमें बताना पड़ता है. ये कुडा खुद से हमारे सी कोड को कन्वर्ट नहीं कर पाता है, या अभी तक उसने कोई ऐसा टूल भी नहीं बनाया है जो कन्वर्ट कर पाए. तो हमें ये खुद से ध्यान रखना पड़ता है कि कितना थ्रेड हमें चाहिए होगा, किस तरह से थ्रेड को हम लोग डायमेंशन उसका बनाए, एक वेक्टर हम लोग बना दें या फिर ग्रिड में बनाए तो ज्यादा अच्छा रहेगा. मोर ओवर, मैंने तुम्हें शायद ये बताया कि नहीं, हम लोग कितने थ्रेड्स, हमारे कितने थ्रेड्स हो सकते हैं इन वन ब्लॉक. नहीं नहीं, इट इज मल्टीपल ऑफ 32 थ्रेड्स. मल्टीपल ऑफ 32 थ्रेड्स बट लेस देन 1024. ओके, So it doesn't matter वो किस तरह से होगा, मे बी इट कैन बी 16 क्रॉस 16 क्रॉस 2, इफ एट ऑल इट इज लेस देन 124, 1024, इट कैन बी 1 कॉमा 16 कॉमा 16. नेक्स्ट, मोनू, मोनू, डिड यू अंडरस्टैंड क्या हुआ इसमें? सो यू कैन राइट अ प्रोग्राम फॉर एडिशन ऑफ टू वेक्टर्स. ओके, लेट मी आस्क राहुल रंजन. राहुल, राहुल, विश्व दीपक, राहुल रंजन. ओके, सो राहुल, डू यू थिंक वी कैन हैव, अच्छा ओके, व्हाट डू यू सी इन दिस इमेज? What have you understood? Huh? Rahul. Actually, your sound is not coming. Are you saying something? Okay, you might be saying something but we are not able to listen to you. You can write something in the comment box. I will read it for you. So my question is, now can you all work on writing this program for addition of two vectors? Okay. क्या डिफिकल्टी है? ओके, एक वीडियो मैंने फिर से बनाया था और ये वीडियो मैंने डाला था. ये सेकंड वीडियो तुम लोगों ने नहीं देखा है अभी. ओके, उसमें मैंने इसी प्रोग्राम को लिखा है, हाँ, और उसे मैंने एग्जीक्यूट करके वहां पे दिखाया है कि कैसे वो एग्जीक्यूट कर सकता है. ओके, और उधर हमने किस पे लिखा है, इधर गूगल कोलैब लेगी. ठीक है, so I am trying to confirm from you that you all will you all will be able to execute this program or not? Write in comment box. सबको लिखना है. CUDA program for local memory, any tutorial for that, sir? So Rahul Ranjan Om Swarup. Okay, most of you, okay, almost all of you are saying yes sir, you can write this program. So definitely write this program and execute it, and I am making a column there in Google Colab, sorry, Google classroom, to share this, share your what we call it, assignment, huh? Let us treat it as assignment, and you will send it to me. No problem. I will make a column for assignment, huh? Okay, so for now, today we are stopping here only. Okay, all of you should join this classroom, Google Classroom. Actually, I tried to work on Moodle, but this is also Google Classroom is actually okay. In Moodle, we were having more options. But it's okay, no issues. Classroom is more faster. And
so what's the current scenario regarding
academics? Current scenario, actually in Manipur we are open. Huh? Manipur mein zyada problem nahi hai. So yahan sab khula hua hai. But students are from क्वारंटाइन एक्चुअली बना के रखा जा रहा है क्योंकि बाहर से अगर यहाँ के लोगों को मणिपुर के लोगों को बाहर से लाया जाएगा तो कुछ सेंटर्स और बने हुए हैं कुछ हॉस्पिटल्स में है बट हो सकता है वो इनफ ना हो इसलिए प्रिकॉशनरी को रखा गया है अभी किसी का रूम खोला नहीं गया है ना लेकिन अगर जरूरत पड़ेगा तो शायद खोलना पड़ सकता है ऐसा है अभी तक मेन प्रॉब्लम है कि फाइनल एग्जामिनेशन कैसे लेंगे वो अगर हम लोग डिसाइड कर पाएंगे वो हम लोग क्या वो लोग हायर ऑफिशियल्स भी अभी ठीक से डिसाइड नहीं कर पा रहे हैं वो लोग कोशिश कर रहे हैं इसका एक सॉल्यूशन निकालने का अगर वो कुछ निकल पाएगा तो हो सकता है कि हम लोग ऑनलाइन पे भी काम कर पाए लेकिन मुझे ऐसा लग रहा है बोलो बोलो मैं बोल रहा था कि अभी हमें लगता है कि अपने क्लासेज और अपने कोर्स को कम से कम ऑनलाइन पे खत्म करके रखना चाहिए हमें जब जैसा जरूरत हो उस हिसाब से हम लोग हैंडल कर सके है ना ठीक है आज के लिए हम लोग यहाँ पे करते हैं बंद और फिर हम लोग अगली बार मिलेंगे जैसे जरूरत हो तुम लोग उसमें भी बता सकते हो कि अभी उसमें भी गूगल क्लासरूम में भी चैट का ऑप्शन है शायद कुछ डिस्कशन अगर करना हो वहाँ भी शायद कर सकते है ना चलो वो आज इसके बारे में अनाउंस करने वाले हैं अच्छा ठीक है अनाउंस करते हैं तो भी देखते हैं Chitiz is there. Okay, bye. Chitiz is saying, हाँ Chitiz, क्या है बोलो? क्षितिज कुछ बोलना चाह रहे हैं नेटवर्क प्रॉब्लम है हेलो। हाँ सर बोल। ओहो हाँ
मैंने रिकॉर्ड तो किया है कुछ, तो देखते हैं क्या होगा, लेकिन मैंने माइक्रोफोन लगाया नहीं। वो तो नेटवर्क का इशू था, लेकिन ना मैं एक चीज भूल गया, एक माइक्रोफोन ऐसे लगाना चाहिए, तो हेडफोन अगर लगा। मैंने यही कोशिश किया था कि आज का जो मीटिंग होता है उसी का वीडियो भी बन जाता, तो क्लास भी हो जाता और वही बना भी।
हम्म।